Hello, everybody. Welcome to Squirrel Pie Productions, my podcast about knitting, spinning, and sewing. My name is Tommy, and you can find me on Ravelry as Dynamite Trujillo and on Instagram as Squirrel Pie Productions. This is Squirrel, the cat, joining us today for episode number 11. Welcome to all new and returning viewers. I really, really appreciate you spending a little bit of time with me. If you're a returning viewer, thank you so much for coming back week after week. It means a lot to me. And if you are a new viewer, thank you so much for checking out my podcast. It's really awesome that you're here. It means a lot to me, and I hope you enjoy yourself. So, we have a Ravelry group for the podcast under Squirrel Pie Productions. That is where you'll find the show notes for this episode and all previous episodes. It's also where you are able to join in the knit-along that we are having right now, which is the Contrast Cow. This is a knit-along for socks, where you can knit a pair of socks with contrasting heels, cuffs, and toes, and enter in the Ravelry group to win some fabulous prizes. So get knitting some socks, and I got a cat settling in on me right now. She's adjusting herself. Get to knitting your socks, contrasting heels, cuffs, and toes, and join in the chatter thread. Put your picture of your finished socks in the FO thread. Join in on Instagram, hashtag ContrastCal. And it's been a lot of fun. I've knit one pair of socks so far. Hopefully I've got another one coming by the end of the month. The knit along will run until March 31st. So get all of your FOs in the FO thread by March 31st. Whips allowed. And is that all I have to say about the Contrast Cow? I think so. There are some really, really beautiful FOs in the FO thread. I'm just loving what you guys are doing. It's so cool. The yarns you guys are using are beautiful. So keep up the good work. It is a Friday in March, and it's a beautiful, cool, foggy day here on the Northern California coast where I'm coming to you from. Today I am drinking some coffee to keep me warm. It's actually some coffee that I bought in Hawaii when I was there. It was one of very few souvenirs I brought home. I only bought and brought home for myself a bag of coffee beans and two little teeny jars of honey and a mason jar of goat cheese in olive oil, which was amazing. The coffee is good, but the cheese and the honey were just intense. They're so amazing. I still have the honey left. I've been eating it slowly, and the cheese is gone. They packed it. It was Chev, so it was fresh goat cheese that was raised there on the island. And they packed it in olive oil and put it in a mason jar, which kept it fresh. For he said it would stay like that for unrefrigerated for a couple weeks, and it didn't last that long at all. It's totally gone. But anyway, Hawaii coffee, it's delicious. And today I've got some knitting to share with you. But first I'll talk about where I'm at. I'm in a new location. This is my office. I've normally recorded from my living room. So today you're seeing kind of my sanctuary. This is where all my stuff lives. It's a bedroom in our house that I kind of called dibs on when we bought this house and moved in. And it's my office. It's got my sewing machine and my stash, which is right over there. You can see a little bit of my fiber stash there. All my books are over here. I've got two big old bookshelves. I'm a book collector. I have a lot of books. I have too many books. Before I started stashing yarn, the thing that I had too much of was books. Now it's yarn. Well, it's both. Anyway, yeah, I love this room. I spend a lot of time in here, and like I said, it's got all my stuff in it. It's got all my toys in it. I'm kind of a toy adult. I'm an adult who likes toys, which I'll talk a little bit about later too. So, yeah, we're going to try it out in here today, and we'll see how that goes. So, first off, I'll talk about what I'm wearing. This is a pullover that I made after, that's so funny. I didn't realize this when I put it on. But another Maria Monska inspired garment knit. So last week I wore my herbarium pullover, which I saw Maria Monska knit from on the Stitched in Sweden podcast. So I copied her and I made one. Same thing with this pullover. I saw her knit a Cybella pullover on her podcast and I copied her because I loved it so much. And this is it. So this is the Cybella pullover by Carrie Bostic Hogue. And I love it. I love this sweater so, so much. It's got this lace detail on the top. 3/4 length sleeves, which is my favorite. And then just a stockinette body. Let's see if I can make this happen. Yeah. I love this sweater so much. And I knit this out of Quince & Co. Chickadee, which is the sport weight. Yeah, so that's what I'm wearing. It's keeping me warm today because it's cold here still. So now I'll show you my first FO. I have one finished object this week and it's another one of my pairs of socks that I finished. I'm so excited. So these are the Neon Tiger socks. The yarn is Hey Holly Ho Hum in her Frankly Lisa colorway. And I love them so, so much. These socks are awesome. So these colors are pretty much what I like to call muted neons. They're so bright. They're so happy. And I love them. They actually worked out a little funky, but it's okay. I still love them. This is the second sock. And what's funky about them is that they're not exactly the same size. They have slightly different gauges than each other. I don't know what that's all about. I don't know. I don't know why that happened, but it did. And I finished the first sock and it fit great. And then I finished the second sock and it was tight. And I was like, what the heck? I'm pretty sure I counted my rounds right, but I went back and checked. And generally what I do when I'm knitting my second sock is I will count the rounds that I've knit between the last gusset decrease and the first toe decrease, and I'll make a match. That's what I do, and it's always worked fine. And so I recounted my rows or my rounds, and they matched. And I was like, what? That's weird. Maybe I messed up on my toe. Maybe I like forgot some rounds between decreases. So on this, the second one, I ripped out the toe because I was pretty sure that's what I did wrong. And I re-knit the toe like the same night that I finished the thing, which was like, but whatever. And I tried it on and it was still tight. And I was like, what? That's weird. So I ripped it out again. And I didn't even think to check my gauge. But I ripped it out again thinking that maybe I messed up again, because it was kind of late at night, and so I knit again. I knit this toe 3 times, and they were still tight. And I was just like, forget it. I'm going to block them and see how they fit after that. And one of them's still a little tighter than the other one. And finally, after they were dry, I looked at them and saw that the gauges were totally different. Pretty much, you can tell that not only is one longer than the other one, this is so ridiculous. I'm not changing them though, they're fine. One's longer, but also the shorter one is skinnier. So the gauge on my second one was tighter, but you know what? I'm not worried about it. I tried them on after they were done drying and they still fit fine. They both fit, one's just a teeny bit more snug. But you know what? As you wear them, they kind of loosen up a little bit anyway, so they're comfortable. And you know what? I've actually decided that with my box of socks this year, this is pair number 3, by the way, for my box of socks. I've decided to try and not wear any of them until 2018 when I'm finished knitting all 12 pairs. And by then, I'm probably going to forget that one is bigger than the other one. And I probably won't notice. And if I do, you know what, whatever. I still love them, even though they are not totally matchy matchy. So they are 56 stitches, 2x2 cuff, heel flap and gusset, and the rounded toe with the Kitchener finish. And I love them. I love Hey Holly Ho Hum so much. She dyes incredibly beautiful yarn. I really love this yarn because it's variegated, so it does that thing where it stripes. It's kind of got these micro stripes where each round is pretty much a different color. But within some of those rounds, it has speckles of the same color of that round. So her speckles aren't contrasting. Like in the light teal sections, there's dark teal speckles. And in the light magenta sections, there's dark magenta speckles. It's so pretty. I love how she did that. So, sock pair number 3 for my box of socks, which of course is a year-long knit-along being hosted by Kristen of the Yarngasm podcast. So, yes. I have one more pair of socks on the needles, which I haven't worked on at all. I didn't work on them at all last week, which is totally weird. Because last week I was knitting on like all the socks. And now I've got one pair and I didn't touch them. So hopefully I'll get those done this week because I really want to cast on another pair of socks. I really want to join in on Tessa of Interim Knits Podcast's Natural Socks Knit Along, where you knit a pair of socks out of all natural fibers, so no nylon and no superwash. And I have the perfect sock yarn for it. And I've got, it's Morning Bright Yarns, I think is what it is. And it's this organic merino, non-superwash, 100% merino. And I've got a light color full skein and then the dark color mini skein. So I'm going to do contrasting heels, cuffs, and toes with those. So I really want to get those on the needles next. So we're going to finish my Fiber Nymph Dye Work socks this week. Doing it. Doing it. That's my only FO. Next, I'll show you my scant whip section. Because, like I said, I haven't been working on a lot of different things this week, which is weird for me, but. So my first whip is living in my Cats in Antlers bag, which I made for myself a long time ago. It's got a pink zipper. Yeah. And in here is living something that I am knitting out of very, very old hand spun. This is a chain plied worsted weight hand spun out of Spun Right Round Merino. And it is the Rock and Roll Love Letter colorway. That was the fiber. And this was my very first attempt at spinning and plying with a chain ply style. And it came out very ropey. So it's definitely not my best hand spun, but it's very old stash and I'm very glad to be using it. I've always loved the colors in this and it's really cool how they're striping. This is also the first time I've knit with any chain plied yarn that I've spun. So that's really nice. It's really beautiful in color. The fiber was really beautiful and soft and crimpy and lovely. The finished yarn though, like I said, it's ropey, it's kinky, it's over spun and over plied maybe. It's over something. I over somethinged somewhere in spinning this yarn, and probably about maybe 2 years ago. But I have decided to make some fingerless mitts out of this yarn because I don't have any right now and I want some. So here's the cuff for the one I'm working on right now. And this right here is just a 1x1 rib. I am knitting these. Well, first of all, I'll tell you, I'm knitting these fingerless mitts using a pattern from this book. It's Ann Budd's Knitter's Handy Book of Patterns. And I have found this book super, super helpful when it comes to knitting fingerless mitts, mittens, and hats. Pretty much the layout of this book is you find your gauge, you find your size, and it's like a chart. So it's, I'm so not in school anymore, but it's one of those charts where like your size is up here and your gauge is down here, and then you find the number from those two numbers. It's really helpful. And so I'm doing the mittens pattern, which is this right here. And I found my numbers, I found my gauge, I found my size. And I'm just gonna not do the fingers, they'll be fingerless mitts. That's how I made my last pair of fingerless mitts, which is now gone because I gifted them. And they fit great, I love them. And so, here is the first one that I have mostly done. As Yolanda of Happy Knits would say, this is a mofo, which is a mostly finished object. I love that so much. She got that from another podcaster too, and I'm gonna start using it. So this is what I have so far on this mofo. And I love how the color's striped up on this. It is just really, really cool. And the nice thing about using this early handspun for fingerless mitts is that it doesn't really matter that it's kind of ropey and dense, because I kind of want that. This doesn't need to be super soft. It doesn't need to be super bouncy and fluffy, because they're meant to keep my hands warm, and that's it. So they're nice and snug, which is how I like my mitts. And they are 1x1 rib, just stockinette, 1x1 rib up here too. And I did a long tail standard cast on. And my bind off is one that I learned from the Very Pink Knits YouTube channel. She does amazingly good tutorials for everything. And I found this bind off that I love. And I use it a lot when I bind off in ribbing and I don't do a tubular bind off. And I'll link to it in the show notes. It's a really, really good bind off. I like it a lot. It's nice and stretchy, but it's not messy looking. So Rock and Roll Love Letter was the colorway for this fiber, and I love it. It's teals and pinks and maroons and this blue, and I can't wait to be able to wear these out. So mitt number one, and I love these color transitions that you get with the chain ply, because all the colors are kept together. And when, look at this right here, isn't that cool? I love it. So with the chain ply, in case you're interested and you don't already know, when you're spinning singles for your finished yarn, generally for a three ply, a traditional three ply, you would spin three singles individually and then ply all those singles together for your three ply. So any colors in any of your singles would get mixed up in your final yarn. With a chain ply, you take all of your fiber, spin it into one long single, and then as you ply it back on itself throughout the whole single. So you're kind of taking the single, folding it back on itself as you go. So all the color progression in the entire single gets condensed, but it stays in the same order, if that makes any sense. So if you have color repeats, they're all gonna stay in that same order, and they're all gonna stay the way they were originally dyed, pretty much. And so that's what happened here. The whole blue section stayed together, the whole pink section stayed together, and in my spinning, when those sections were converging, you get that cool effect. And I love it. I love how these are coming out. I really wanna do some more chain ply and hopefully do them a little better and knit some other stuff with it. You can tell in this, see that little pigtail right there? That's bad spinning. There's a lot of that in here. So I am knitting these on a size 7, Haya Haya Sharp from my interchangeable set. And there's the cuff for the second one. And this one's starting at the bottom on the maroon, and this one started at the bottom on the teal. So they're going to be mismatchy, and I can't wait. I cannot wait until these are done and I get to wear them. Look at that. Look at how over whatever this is. I can never really tell if my yarn is overspun or overplied. I get the basic mechanics of it, but I don't know. Like I've said before, I'm not that technical of a spinner, so this is over somethinged. But I'm really enjoying this project. It's super quick. This did not take me that long at all. And hopefully these will be done soon so that I can wear them out on my morning walks, because it is still cold here and I go on a walk every morning early in the morning when it's freezing, and I need me some fingerless mitts to keep my hands warm. So here's the tag for the original fiber that I spun. Like I said, this is spun right round. And she is a fantastic dyer. I love Spun Right Round. She's on Etsy. And she dyes really beautiful, really unique colors. I used to be a member of her fiber club, so I've got a lot of her fiber. And God, her fiber is amazing. She uses a lot of really bright, but not necessarily primary bright, not necessarily neon bright, but just beautiful, creamy, bright pops of color in her fiber. It's beautiful. And her yarn's beautiful too, but I've never tried it. I've always wanted to get some of her yarn. But Rock and Roll Love Letter. I got 176 yards of my hand spun. And you know me, my yardage on my hand spun is like always inaccurate, I'm pretty sure. But I'm going to have plenty for these mitts, and I'm sure I'll have a bunch left over too. So we'll see what I do with it. Maybe I'll knit some birds of happiness. Maybe I will start a hand-spun crochet blanket. Maybe I will knit a pair of mini mitts for a niece. I don't know. We'll see. I'll add it to my worsted stash, my worsted scrap stash. So cats and antlers, new fingerless mitts, love it. Have you guys seen, I'm sure you have you guys seen the new Stephen West mystery knit along? Are you gonna do it? I really wanna do it, but I don't think I'm gonna do it. I really want to, but I don't want to. I want to because I've never knit a Stephen West pattern, and I've always wanted to, and it looks beautiful, and I love how the marled thing is happening. So it's, okay, so it's called the Marled Magic Mystery Cal, and one of the really big reasons that I wanted to do it was because on Instagram, he did an Instagram contest where he wanted you to take a picture of your yarn ideas for his mystery knit along and have a cat in the picture. And it's the hashtag keep on knitting kitten, I think. And I think it ends today, and then he's gonna like draw prizes or something like that. But I really wanted to do that contest because cats. By the way, have you seen his This Is a Cat video? I saw that last Friday, I think maybe the day it came out. I watched it like 5 times. It's really good. Stephen West YouTube video, This Is a Cat. Watch it if you haven't. Anyway, so yeah, he's got this mystery knit along that he's doing. He does a lot of these, I think once a year or something. And I'm always tempted to do them, but I never do them because I don't do mystery knit alongs because I'm picky and I'm afraid I'm not gonna like what I get, especially if I choose my colors not knowing where they're gonna go. So I've never done one, but I really want to do this one. But then I'm pretty sure I'm not gonna do it, and I'm not gonna tell you why. Today he came out with like a spoiler video for the first clue, because the first clue is released today, which is Friday, and there's one part about it that I pretty sure I'm gonna hate the actual knitting of, so I don't think I'm gonna do it. But we'll see. We'll see as I see other people's objects, whips, then if I do it or not. Anyway, what was I talking about? My next whip. So my next whip, of course, is living in my Gastly's bag. And I have, and I'm going to get into this a little bit later, but I've got, I'll show you now, a new little zipper pull. It's a unicorn. This is a Tokidoki Unicorno. Unicorn. So this is my Girl from the Grocery Store shawl. This is a pattern by Hohi Locatelli, and it's called The Girl from the Grocery Store. It was inspired by the Grocery Girls podcast, and this is what I've got so far. So this is what I've mostly been working on this week. Last time when I showed it to you, I was kind of down here-ish. I had the gray all done, and I finished this purple section. And now I have started on the maroon section. And this is a gradient that I spun. I've got my taco progress keeper on here, because I love tacos. I'm making tacos tonight for dinner, in case you wanted to know that. I'm making chili verde, pork and green sauce, and beans and rice. It's gonna be good. Anyhow, this is my, I'm calling it my femme fatale from the grocery store. It is an elongated triangular shawl, and I love it so far. I really, really, really love how it's turning out. I had this on my knit picks on a size US 6 knit picks interchangeable needle, the wood ones. And I said last time that I was liking it enough to keep it on those, but I wasn't. My yarn was snagging a lot, and I changed it. I've got my project now on my signature size 6, and it's working out a lot better. They're not snagging anymore, which is good, because this is a single ply hand spun, and on the join of those knit picks needles, it was just every time it was catching, and I felt like it was kind of like almost fraying my yarn in places, and I had to change it. So I changed it out. And here is the yarn in the cake. This is my hand spun. This was a loop bump. And it's merino, nylon, and stellina. I spun this as a fingering-ish weight, kind of a light fingering, single ply yarn. This was my first time doing a single ply yarn. In hand spun, and I love it. I love it a lot. I definitely want to do it again, and I'm really love knitting with it. I'm really loving knitting with it. It's really pleasurable. I mean, it feels pretty comparable to Madeline Tosh Merino Light as I'm knitting with it, which I love. I love Tosh Merino Light, and I'm getting the same vibe from this yarn. So this has been really, really fun to work on. I've mostly been working on this, and I love it. And when I spun this yarn, I pretty much was going for a fingering weight single ply. It's pretty uneven though. In sections, it's definitely a really light lace weight. And I don't think in any sections it really goes over a fingering weight, but it's pretty variable. You've got sections like this that are kind of slubby and sections that are thinner. And you can see that in the whip, but that's okay. So you can kind of see that there's sections that are a little more see-through than others, but I think it looks really good. I like it a lot. I cannot wait to wear this. Oh, I love knitting with single ply yarn. I really, really love it, especially for shawls. I think it's really pleasurable. I think the finished objects in a single ply yarn for shawls are just, they're my favorite. They're the squishiest, they're the softest, and I love them. And, okay, so when I spun this, I was going for a fingering weight single ply. And I wanted to keep it as a single ply because this was a gradient bump of fiber. And I wanted to keep it as a gradient. So my two options pretty much were, well, my three options were to keep it as a single ply, to chain ply it the way I did with that other yarn. Oh, by the way, hey, both my whips are hand spun. Anyway, my third option was to spin the whole bump in one single ply and then spin another fiber of a single color, single ply, and then ply those two together so that it would be marled, but it would be one ply a solid color, one ply a gradient. And I didn't want to do that either. I decided that a single ply yarn would be my best option for a shawl, and I was right. I love it. I love it, I love it, I love it. And then when I washed it, I thwacked it just a tiny, tiny bit. So I soaked my yarn and then I rolled it up in a towel and walked on it and got all the moisture out. And then from there, instead of just kind of going like that with it, which I usually do with my yarns that I'm washing, I'll kind of like snap it between my hands. Instead of just doing that, I actually took it and I banged it on the floor onto my towel, just like twice. And that is called thwacking, and it essentially felts your yarn a teeny, teeny bit. Since it's a single ply, they say you're supposed to do that, I think, for structure. So I tried it, and it worked fine. I mean, the yarn itself isn't, like, felty. So I don't know, I don't really know what it did. But it's great. I like it. I like how it came out. Yeah, I'm really happy with it, and I love these colors. I just love these colors so much. It's the gray that goes into purple, and I'm right now in this kind of wine color, and then it's going to this mauve, which is my favorite. These two here are my favorites. And then, of course, this hot pink. And this hot pink is going to be the big, long section at the end of the elongated triangle. And I can't wait. There's some lace at the end of this shell. I think it's going to look really, really good. So that's my progress on that so far. I am completely in love with it. Thank you, Hohe Locatelli, for writing beautiful patterns. Thank you, the Grocery Girls, for being awesome. And thank you, Loop Fiber Studios, for this amazing fiber that I was able to turn into yarn. I love it. I love it. So that's all my knitting. Not much this week. But I've also got a little bit of spinning, just a tiny bit, and I'm not going to take my bobbin off the wheel, but I will show you the fiber. I've actually shown this to you before. I am working on this right now. I have a lot of it. I have a lot more of what you see here. I think I have several pounds of this fiber. And what this fiber is one sheep fleece and one alpaca fleece that I had processed together into roving. So the sheep fleece I got from my local yarn shop. Somebody who raises sheep in the area had a fleece that got washed, but not processed, and gave it to the yarn shop because of whatever reason. I don't know why. They didn't want it. And my local yarn shop just had it sitting in their back room for a long time and didn't know what to do with it. So they asked me if I wanted it because they knew I'm a spinner. And so I took it. And like I said, it was washed but not processed, and I don't process fleece or wash it. So it was sitting in my garage for quite a while, not doing anything. And then I got an alpaca fleece from a coworker's sister-in-law's alpaca. They just have alpacas for pets, and they get them sheared, and never do anything with the fleeces. So they gave me one of their fleeces. Both were dark brown, and I sent it off to Sherry of Morrow Fleeceworks and had them blended into this robing. And it's really, really beautiful. So it's 50% alpaca, 50% wool. And I love it. I have got so much of it, several pounds. And what I'm going to do for this first batch of it is hopefully spin it into a bulky weight and make the Sonder, which is a shawl pattern by Helen Stewart. And I'm in the middle of that right now. I'm working on the first section of spinning. I am spinning this woolen style. And I'm not quite sure yet what exactly the yarn's gonna be. I've got the single going right now. It's ending up kind of a heavy fingering, maybe a sportish single. And so I'll spin a bunch of that, a bobbin's worth, and then my second bobbin, I'll spin the same. And I'll see what that looks like as a two-ply, and if I feel like it needs to be a little thicker, then I'll spin a third bobbin and make it a three-ply. And then I'm hoping to knit the Sonder, which is a really beautiful pattern intended for bulky weight yarn. It's a shawl. It's an elongated triangle. It's not knit on the bias like my last one was. It's just knit. It starts at a point, and then it gets bigger and bigger and bigger, and it ends on a straight line. And it's got tassels, which is awesome. So yeah, I've been working on this. It's been really, really fun. I'm not that far into it yet, but it's been really nice drafting in a woolen style. I haven't done much of that. Most of the spinning that I do is worsted, short, forward, and backward draw. I try to do long draw, which is the woolen style, every once in a while, and I'm not really that good at it, for one, and I always try to find a fiber where that style of drafting will work easily and naturally. This one it did, so I continued doing it, and it's really, it's fun. It's a little nerve-wracking trying to keep up with it, because instead of like drafting out your fiber in controlled incremental bits, you have less control. You're holding onto it less. You're kind of letting it go as you're drafting. So you have less control, and it can get away from you, or at least it can get away from me kind of easily. So the whole time I'm spinning, now that I'm still like getting used to it, I'm like, oh my God, like, oh, it's coming up. So, it's been really fun though. I can't wait for the finished yarn, and I can't wait to start that shawl. I think it's a really beautiful shawl. And that's it for spinning. Next up, I have done some dyeing. That has been so much fun. I did another dye session this last week. I dyed 4 skeins of yarn, and I had so much fun with it. I love dyeing so much. It's really becoming something I want to do more and more with my weekends. I love it. So let me show you what I did. I am going to start out with the two that I like more. So I've got this 2-ply yarn, and it's 100% superwash merino. It's a very loosely spun 2-ply, and this is what I dyed on that. So this first one is mostly natural. With pops of color. I have got some blues, some gray, some pink, some purple in here. Let me take my rings off so that I don't ruin my thing. So that's it. It's mostly natural, pretty sparsely speckled with some of my favorite colors. Blues, purples, pinks, grays. And I really like this. I really want to put this in a shawl. This yarn is really nice. Like I said, it's a loosely spun 2-ply. It's too loosely spun for my taste for socks. So I think it'll make a really beautiful color in like a 2 or 3 color shawl. So that's the first one. I've been naming all the yarns that I dye, but I have not named this colorway because I haven't thought of anything yet. But if you have any ideas, let me know for any of these because I haven't named any of them. So that's the first one. The second one I am pretty happy with. It is a tonal blue with pops of pink. And there it is. It's got several shades of blue in here along with some gray. And then just some, I was going for pink speckles over the top of it. But we are still experimenting. So far what I've been doing when I dye is I kind of just start out with the bare yarn and throw stuff in and experiment. I haven't so far gone into any dye experiment with any real plans of what I want it to look like, because I'm not that experienced yet. But so far I've been really, really happy with what's coming out. I am considering putting these two in a shawl together, as a 2-color shawl, or possibly dyeing a 3rd color and doing a 3-color shawl. So I don't know. We'll see. We'll see if those come out as something together. My next two skeins are two skeins that I overdyed. I believe I showed both of these to you several episodes ago. It's two skeins of yarn that I dyed in a dye workshop at my local yarn shop years ago that I was unhappy with. It was a hand paint and microwave workshop, and I didn't really like the method. I didn't enjoy hand painting really, and I thought what I came out with was really ugly, so I never used it. So I've had these two skeins of yarn sitting around in my stash forever, looking at me in the face, and we haven't liked each other, me and these two skeins of yarn. So I overdyed them, and they came out okay. I don't know, they came out okay. They're better than they were before, I think. I'll show you the one that I think is better first. So this one was a really pastel set of colors. There was like an ochre that I made too dark. So it was like this weird kind of brownish buttery sort of color, but that sounds nice, but not in a good way. And it had some pinks and some purples, and it was kind of muddy looking. It wasn't great. So I overdyed it with pink and purple, and I went for some black speckles in this. And I'm pretty happy with it. I kind of did like a gradient-ish sort of thing with this one. I thought it came out kind of neat. So it's mostly pink, but it's got this one section of purple that kind of gradiates out in either direction. And I like it okay. You can still see some of the colors underneath, or at least some splotchiness underneath from the old colors. But I think it came out pretty good. This is a BFL yarn. I'm not sure whether or not it has nylon in it. And the yarn itself isn't my favorite. I did dye a 3rd color back in my old dye workshop that I did make into socks, and I didn't love the yarn, but I'll use this for something. They'll probably be socks someday, and I do like the color a lot more than it was before, so this was an improvement. Yeah, look at those. I got some black speckles in there, kind of. Cool. So there's that one. And the one that I liked the least going into, I kind of like the least still, but it's way better than it was before. So this was the Flintstones skein. It looked like the Flintstones. I had used a peach color, and the workshop was, it wasn't great. I thought I was gonna be taught how to dye in this workshop, but there was no instruction. It was just, it was a workshop. It was, here's a bunch of dyes that you can use, go for it. So I didn't know what I was doing. I had no idea what I was doing. And they had dye stock there of this peach color, and I wanted like a peach semi-solid with speckles of brown. And I didn't know back then that you couldn't do speckles with a sponge and hand painting techniques. So I used the peach dye stock way too strong, and it came out this super bright neon orangey peach with just big fat brown splotches on top. It looked like the Flintstones. Anyway, so that's what it was. This is what it is now. This I just over dyed with some brown tones. And it's way better. I don't know what I'll use this for. I still don't think it's really my style. It's still, you can still see a lot of what was underneath in this one. A lot of those splotches you can see are still there. A lot of the oranginess is still there. But it looks decent now, I feel like. I feel like now it just looks like a tonal, brown, basic kind of color. So I don't know what I'll do with this, but I've got it, and it's way better than it was before. You can still see a lot of the orange in right there from where it was, from how orange it was before. So that's been my dye experimenting this week, and I had so much fun doing that. I had so much fun doing that. Putting on my big clunky respirator for safety, but it's fun. It's pink. And it's huge, and it makes me feel cool. And an apron, I put on music. I have one dye pot right now, so the process is a little slow because I did one skein at a time. So hopefully I'll get another pot. I have like a stock pot, and I think I want to get a roasting pan for some shallower dyeing techniques. So I'm excited to keep experimenting with that. It is so much fun. I love it. And that's it for dyeing. What else have I got? That's it for everything fibery. I will talk a little bit about what I want to knit in the future. I'm still thinking about that Stephen West mystery knit along. Like I said, I'm gonna wait and see what things start to look like before I decide. I probably won't do it though, because like I said before, there's this one aspect of it that I'm just like, so I don't know, we'll see. But I've got my eye on it. It looks really cool. I think it's probably gonna be beautiful. And then I received a pattern in the mail last week that is so cool, and I'm thinking about what stash yarn I can use for it. Jenny of the Handmade in Woolen podcast really kindly gifted me a pattern called Goldfish Memory by Casapinka, and it's a really beautiful shawl. It's a rectangular shawl with diagonal stripes on the bias, diagonal stripes throughout it, and it's really my style. It's right up my alley. So check that out. I'll have a link to it in the show notes. It's a really beautiful shawl. And I'm thinking about doing that maybe in this hand-dyed yarn with a third color that I can hopefully come up with. I'm also thinking about doing the Pure Joy shawl by Hohe Locatelli with also my hand-dyed yarn. I thought the speckle and that blue would be really cool together. So we'll see. I don't know. And then the last thing I'm going to talk about today is how I kind of went crazy on the toy front. I last week needed a little bit of retail therapy. So I went online and I went toy shopping. I know, I'm an adult. I'm in my 30s. And as retail therapy, I went toy shopping. So I'm going to show you what I got because it's awesome. First of all, I went on Etsy and I decided I wanted some more polymer clay charms. I have a couple from Super Miniatures that I love. And I went looking around on Etsy and I found this guy. This is Coochie Kopi. Coochie Kopi is kind of a character from the show Bob's Burgers. I love Bob's Burgers. It's a cartoon that's really good. It's a cartoon with John Benjamin in it. He's a cartoon voiceover guy, and I've loved everything he's ever done. He's my favorite. I love him. And this is one of his shows, Bob's Burgers. I'm sure you've seen it. It's like on Primetime or something, I think. And one. There's a character in Bob's Burgers named Louise. She's one of his kids. And she loves these Japanese figures. And this one is called Coochie Kopi. So this is like a fake TV show in a TV show kind of character. And I love him. There's an episode with him as a primary character. And I'm so happy I have this now. So this is from a shop called Charmed and Dangerous. It's a really, really great shop. I will link to her in the show notes. And I had a business card around here somewhere for her, but I lost it. So you can find her link there. You should definitely check out her shop if you like these kind of charms and progress keepers. It's got the little lobster claw on it, so I can put it on my knitting. And I love him so much. He makes me so happy. Me and Louise now share toys. And along with my Coochie Kopi progress keeper, she sent me this little kawaii star. Isn't it adorable? I love it. And this has also got a lobster claw on it. So, two new progress keepers that I can put on my knitting, and I love them. Coochie Kopi and Happy Star. So, thank you, Charmed and Dangerous. Your shop is awesome. Go check her out. Then I went on to the Tokidoki website. Tokidoki is, a brand that has characters, and they sell toys with these characters, and I bought a bunch of them. So, kind of the idea behind these characters is you buy a box from a series, and you don't know which one of these things you're gonna get, and I'll show you what I got. So, they have a series of toys. A character is called Unicorno, and I bought one Unicorno, and you don't know which one you're gonna get. And I got this one. So she is a unicorn with a little mushroom hair clip. She's a unicorn Pegasus because she has wings too. And I love her. So I got a unicorn, and I also got. Okay, so they have this series of characters. I think it's called Donatella, and it's this girl who is a donut girl, and she has donut pets. And I got her. So this is Donatella. She's got donut ears and a donut dress, and she's eating a donut. My next one is a cat. So they have this series of characters of animals that wear cactus costumes. And I got the cat. Wearing a blue and white cactus costume. That is my ridiculous little toy haul for the week. And they make me so happy. I also got that progress keeper, or the zipper pull that I showed you earlier. This is a mini version. I love this one. I think this is actually my favorite thing I got, is this tiny little unicorn. Adding to my toy collection is ridiculous. It's embarrassing almost. I got dinosaurs. I have a lot of dinosaurs. Yeah. my love for toys. What can I say? That's all I've got for you this week. I hope you enjoyed yourselves. If you like the video, give it a thumbs up and hit that subscribe button if you want to be kept up to date on future episodes. And come on over and join the Ravelry group. It's a good place over there to chit chat and join in on the knit along. And I hope you all have a wonderful week. I will see you next time. Bye, guys.